Drink beer. Think beer. You're listening to Brew Bloods.
I'd rather have a bottle in front of me than a frontal lobotomy. That's for me, Tom Waits.
That sounds like a very scary character you're trying to do, but I guess that does kind of sound like him.
Welcome to episode 80 of Brew Bloods. Yes, we had Tom Waits come in and record that quote just for the show. Very special episode. Episode 80, everybody knows, we tend to celebrate in, 20s in sure. The podcast land. So we're celebrating episode 80 that we made it this far. And we almost didn't make it this far because Dustin tried to take a sick day today. And if there's one thing that HR does not allow at this company, we allow all kinds of things. Bestiality. We allow random trips to take, to ride on new roller coasters. We allow farm animals in the studio, but we do not allow sick days
at
this company.
Lots of farm animals in the studio.
Oh, yeah, lots. Lots
you
of
don't
sheep.
That's why we don't have a video podcast. You don't want to see it.
Oh, why wouldn't they? Everybody likes a nice petting zoo. Who doesn't like a nice sheep?
Well, it's on a secret feed. Yeah. Let's just put it that way.
Yes, it's on the secret Periscope feed, since nobody uses Periscope anymore. Welcome to episode 80 of Brew Bloods. Back on the scene, we're kind of coming down off the high of North Texas Beer Week. The last few episodes, I think that was, three episodes worth of material there?
Pretty much.
Kind of coming down on the high. We're coming down off the tryptophan high of Thanksgiving, and where we had the meat sweats in each other's arms. And now we're back to our good old...
The terrible tainted Bourbon County.
That's right, yes. And we're settling back into the doldrums between Thanksgiving and Christmas.
This is more like a regular episode again.
It is. It is. It's just that
I'm actually at a different location, as you'll be able to tell slightly with the quality. Well, that's because it was pretty good. It's pretty good.
Pretty good little audio.
I'm quarantined due to my possible infectionness, so Mark did not want to get a fever and clogged nose and everything that I may have. Although you did tweet today that you were standing in line behind someone at Total Wine that said they were coming down with strep. So.
Yeah, so that was an interesting scene. So Total Wine, the small little craft beer shop that it is. I went there today. I was in the area and decided, need to pick up some beer, need to pick up some whiskey, need to pick up some wine.
Support
and
the local guy.
Yeah, I got to support the tiny guy, right? Although the person who, complained, but said we should support those local shops, we actually did find a new local shop to go to, craft beer cellar, down in Lakewood. It's just that I wasn't in that area today, so I didn't go there. But anyways, so I was at Total Wine today, and I'm standing in line with my multiple bottles of whiskey and wine and beer, and the guy in front of me is telling the customer ahead of me that, he's like, yeah, I think I can tell when I've got strep coming on, and I've got strep coming on right now. He's like, I really need to go to the doctor and get some antibiotics. And he's like, at that point, once you get them, I'll only be contagious for 24 hours. I'm like, okay, thanks, a-hole, for now contaminating my entire, every single bottle that you touch with your strep.
But you're not currently on antibiotics.
Yeah,
so.
Thanks for that. Thanks, guy. Yeah. Appreciate that. Thanks for just announcing that to the entire world. I mean, I appreciate the warning on one hand, but now I have to touch all your strep bottles.
Yeah, exactly.
Now I'm going to get strep, and I've never had strep in my life. Never once.
That is a brag.
It is a brag. Of course it's a brag. Why isn't that's something that should be honored? I should have a crown set upon my head for never having had strep. I've been very lucky in this world, and hopefully I will never have it. Knock on wood. As it were.
Was that wood?
That was actual wood. It is actual wood. It's real wood. We're fancy in this house.
You have a real wood table in there.
That's right. I cut down this tree myself. I hewed this table. I got all kinds of planking and shaving and sandpapers and saws and hammers and wrenches and
stuff.
Pipes and put this table together myself. Handcrafted. Solid balsa wood.
It's a thing.
So anyways, you're sick. You've got diarrhea.
not so much that.
You got the Las Vegas diarrhea. You got the Las Vegas diarrhea. You got the Las Vegas leprosy.
Yeah, I did go, went to Las Vegas with all the dirty, dirty degenerates that do live there and visit there. And yeah, I picked something up from some degenerate. I'm going to call it the degenerate flu. But I'm going to power through it, like Mark said. I'm out of sick days because I didn't have any.
Because we don't allow them. We allow group like orgies. We allow farm animals.
Right.
We allow all kinds of things in this office. We do not allow sick days. That is not a perk that you will receive.
You're allowed to be off, on non-recording days.
Yeah, I mean,
on a recording day, you got to be there.
I mean, frankly, that's the only way we've maintained success in the show. We've not missed an episode since we started this show, and that's because we don't allow sick days. That's we find true. Ways around it. We go through modern technology such as smoke signals and Google Hangouts.
Almost on the same level of technology.
So tell me, before we get talking about beer in Las Vegas, because last time we went, we weren't that impressed, but did you take my advice and did you always split and double down on twos and tens in blackjack?
Yeah, I split every two I could.
And every ten?
So yeah, it made a whole lot of sense. And yeah, in tens, of course. I would split and then double down on each of them and then, you know, hopefully get like a three so I could just lose double the money.
Exactly. I'm sure you won all the blackjack.
I won one sports bet. Did not do great at the electronic blackjack. Did not have a chance to go to the regular blackjack because it was too expensive. Next time I go there, I think, as ghetto as it is, I may go to Hooters because they do dollar blackjack tables.
Nice.
So it may be worth actually trying. But yeah, no, it,
Hooters has a casino?
Yeah, it's right across from the MGM Grand there.
Interesting.
And, you know, last time, I did all right at the Monte Carlo when we stayed there. Did fine. Went over to the MGM. Did not do very well. I think I have some bad karma at the MGM Grand or something. Because I never do well there.
Yeah, I don't blame you. And I really decry the fact that the lower income blackjack tables are going away in Las Vegas. Really, really sucks.
You have to go to the hepatitis-infected Hooters to actually get dollar blackjack tables.
Is that where you got the Las Vegas flu from?
I didn't actually make it over there. Maybe I got it from downtown, which I'll mention later. But no, I did not get it from over there.
All right.
One other note, just a little side note, since we did have a bromance in Vegas at the Monte Carlo, I do want to let you know they are going to change the name of that, and they are making it a high-end hotel that'll probably be one of the more pricey ones on the whole strip.
It's Motel 6?
Called The Park or something like that, because they have a new development next to it, and it's next to the T-Mobile Arena, where they're going to have hockey ball starting to play there regularly. I guess they're getting a hockey team. So they want to class it up a little bit, and they're going to pretty much ruin my favorite low-rent, easy-access hotel.
They're going to douche it up. Like, what was that one we went to that had all like the disco lights and whatever? It was like...
Yeah, I think that...
Well, I forgot what that was called.
Aria? I can't remember.
It was the one that connected to the mall.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I think it was the Aria.
Aria. Yeah, the Areola, right.
Yep, unfortunately, they're going to douche it up, so...
The Park.
Yeah, exactly.
Is it one of those where it's the club that's... what is it? Indoor furniture outside?
Yeah, exactly. Although the park is pretty cool. They opened that up in between New York and there, which was all just construction when we were there, but now it has a bunch of different restaurants and alcohol stops, and they...
So,
I don't know. Classed it up a little bit.
What is the park? Is it an outdoor venue or what?
It's like an outdoor venue. The outdoor space between Monte Carlo, New York.
But they're going to rename the Monte Carlo the park?
It's going to be like, Hotel on the Park or something really cheesy.
Okay,
really
so they're not going to have the park and then the park next to it.
Right, exactly.
Is it going to be spelled with a Q like the new apartment building next to just down the street from our house?
It probably will be, yes.
The park in Las Vegas.
That would definitely be my guess. But yeah, that's, overall. Good trip, enjoyable. Definitely made several beer stops. Oh, that Monte Carlo bar that we went to as well, where it had the ton of different beer taps.
Right.
That is now closed.
What?
Yep, that is now closed.
Great.
Yeah, they just pretty much boarded up that entire hallway. It said high-end revamp shops are coming, and I guess that was too low rent for the new The Park.
That place was like super hopping every night we were there.
I know.
So strange. You're weird, Las Vegas. So tell us about outside of that, outside of your, sad Charlie Brown piano as you're walking past that. Tell us about your Las Vegas beer experience.
Well, the Las Vegas beer experience started actually at the Grand. There was a place called Tap. That was a sports bar. They have a few of those around there. So I decided to go in, and it was a place where we went with another couple, me and the wife did, and we were waiting on them to come over, so we're like, why don't we just go ahead and hang out in here, because, the wife was starving, so we stopped in and did that, and decided to go ahead and grab a beer flight there. The beer flights, pretty much, they broke them down by style, so if you wanted all porters or IPAs or whatever, as has been well established, I'm the IPA guy on the show, so
you are.
I went for that. And, pretty much didn't have anything I hadn't had before, but they were all good. It was had a Deschutes Fresh Squeezed, had a New Belgium IPA, had a Firestone Walker IPA, and a Green Flash IPA. The only one that was different in there, at least different to me, I don't remember having this before, is Hop Rising. I don't know if you've had that one, Mark, but
never
it's by Squatters Craft Beers.
Never heard of it.
Yeah, it's a brewery out of Utah, actually, but it was a really good IPA. It's about 9%, nice little Imperial Double IPA, and I enjoyed it quite a bit.
Was this the music going on in tap?
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Would you like an IPA here at tap?
It was actually a lot less douchey than it sounds. Yeah, I agree, it sounds really douchey. That was pretty much tap.
Tap.
Yep, tap. Like I said, not quite as douchey as you would think, but it does sound kind of douchey. You know, that's Vegas, though.
I'm surprised it's not, like, tap out, you know, since they're so, like, you know, handsy-handsy with UFC.
UFC-centric. Yeah.
Although I guess they'd probably just have to call it Reebok at this point, since you can't have tap out anymore.
Yeah, that's true. And I also thought it was funny, just a side note at the Grand, Brad Garrett was again performing at his Brad Garrett Comedy Club, so God, it must be nice to have an ongoing gig anytime you want there.
Yeah, it seems like the guy follows us everywhere.
Pretty much. So after that, the next really, I guess, local beer that I tried was one that you tried with me as well last time we were there. It was over in the Venetian, and it was called Sin City Beers.
Yeah, I vaguely remember that. I remember the logo.
Okay. Yeah, Sin City Beers has a, they have a pretty much standard range of things, you know, a stout and amber, that kind of stuff. But the one I've gotten from them a couple times that I've enjoyed is their double IPA. And got it again and enjoyed it. It wasn't quite as good as I remembered, but, you know, I enjoyed it.
Yeah, I remember just being kind of neither over nor underwhelmed with their beers. I was just whelmed. I wasn't overly impressed by any of their beers, from what I remember.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
It felt like they had the advantage of striking early in that city, and they've clearly made a good profit off that. And
yeah, no kidding.
There's several. Don't they have several extensions throughout the city of where you think it's the actual brewery, but it's not?
They do. Yeah, they definitely do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that must be nice for them.
Yeah, it must be.
Up next was actually a drink in the hotel, because we ran by the Total Wine. Total Wine experience was terrible there. It took about an hour, a little over an hour, due to several register issues they had. They also charged us three times for the same purchase.
Jesus.
Because twice they claimed that it failed, and we needed to move to another register. Found out it was because... Elena had gotten a bottle of the Deep Eddy lemonade, and there was a $2 coupon on there that made it keep failing. We said, how about we forget about that? It's $2, and we want to get the hell out of here. So they gave us the $2 discount. However, the three transactions all cleared for $70 each. So
awesome.
It's been fun to go back and dispute that. So that has no bearing on the actual beer we bought, though, which the next one up was from Joseph James Brewing in Henderson, Nevada. Don't know if you had them while we were out there, Mark.
I don't remember.
They have a beer called the Hot Box Imperial IPA.
Oh, yes.
Imperial Double IPA.
Yes, I did have that. Yeah.
And that, I would say, might have been my... Well, that was my second favorite beer I had out there, for sure.
Yeah, I remember enjoying that quite a bit. Yeah.
Yeah, so I like that one quite a bit. And if you're in that area, I would definitely... grab some of that. Maybe don't go to Total Wine. Maybe go somewhere else. But but do run by and grab some somewhere, because they do have it in cans, so it's convenient that you can walk around with it anywhere on the strip. For anyone that doesn't know, as long as you're not walking around with glass, you can walk around with open containers. It's not a problem. After that, we stopped by a place called Diablo's Cantina, which was in the Monte Carlo, for a massive plate of nachos, and I had a Apocalypse IPA there by Tin Barrel Brewing Company. Don't know if you know who Tin Barrel is, Mark, but nope. I haven't really had much from them looking back through my history. In fact, I think I only had one other thing from them ever, and I don't remember where it was, but not a common one that I've had. It was the one, you know, not standard beer that was on tap there, and I said, why not? It's an IPA. IPA guy, you know, what am I going to go for? And... I have to say, it's one of the worst IPAs I've ever had. It tasted a lot like cigarettes and death.
What was what was the name of the beer again? Tin Barrel was what?
It's called Apocalypse IPA by Tin Barrel Brewing.
That kind of reminds me of what was the one we had that was from L.A. that was tasted like wet cigarettes in an ashtray.
That was like something Angel, wasn't
Angel
it?
Angel City, something like that. Angel City Brewing or something like that. Yeah,
I think it was. Yeah,
they reminded me of wet ashtray. Yeah,
And I will give them another shot at some point. They did tweet at me because I made those comments and said if this was too bitter and nasty, you should try a different they recommended a different beer to try up there. So, you know, maybe I'll give their pale ale a try at some point. But as has been noted on the show, I don't mind really hoppy IPAs.
Right.
Everything I've noted so far has been double IPA. So I don't really think that's what it is. But not to just run down a particular brewery, but that particular beer I would highly recommend passing on. So do not go for the Apocalypse IPA. Go for many other options around town. I would probably go for a Rebel IPA from Sam Adams about 10 times before I'd go for this.
So sad.
Yeah, exactly. To finish it up, we wound up over in downtown. Downtown's a little bit chiller, a little bit more retro. It's a pretty cool experience. It's the one that has the zip lines going through the middle of town. And down the main street there.
Because nothing says retro like zip lines.
Well, you know, that's not the retro part, but it does have like all the old school neon signs and that kind of stuff. It reminds you of old school Vegas for sure. The Golden Nuggets down there.
Did you get your knees broken just by a mafioso just for fun? For some of that retro fun?
He was in a bowler hat and clubbed me in the knees. He said, just to be old school. I was like, can you treat me like someone out of Bugsy? And they did. It's a side tour you can do.
Yeah.
But, so there's a little brew pub, or not brew pub, but a little brewery down there. I don't know if they have any distribution. I tried to look up. I don't really see any distribution. But they're located down there in Fremont, and they are called Banger Brewing.
Oh, and you know what? They're the guys that we tried to get an interview with last time, and I even called them, like, several times and got no response. They're like, oh, yeah, we'll have Senior Banger or whoever, you know, call you back, and got no response last time.
Well, I definitely was able to get in there and at least sample their stuff this time. So, I tried, it was called a Hot Bang Boom, is the name of the beer I tried. And it was a really solid IPA. I enjoyed it quite a bit. And I would actually say that between that and the Hot Box were probably my two favorite experiences there.
Yeah, the reason I contacted them was, never having had their beer, I looked up, you know, what are the top breweries in Las Vegas? And so they were listed as number one. So I called them and was very interested and got no response. I was very disappointed.
Well, if we go back together as a pair, we can just go downtown and ambush them, because there's someone behind the bar that works there, and we could just do a crash interview, because they were very friendly. It was very standard beer nerdy type environment, you know, guys with long beards and drinking lots of high hopped beers. You know, the kind of place that we feel at home in.
Maybe we can wear our pinstripe Brew Bloods suits, and if they refuse us, we'll just break their knees.
Bowler hatted Bugsy guys over there.
Yeah, exactly. Or Warren Beatty clones.
It was a pretty cool setup. You know, it's kind of got that standard industrial look, but at the same time, they had a lot of cups full of different types of grains, and I don't know, it was a little customized. I took one photo.
Were they just like a random assortment of red Solo cups full of grain and hops?
No, it's you know, you could take a look on our Twitter account if you'd like more clarity.
I don't pay attention to that account.
I don't normally either, but I figured I might as well post a couple of pictures. But yeah, that was definitely the best one. It was worth going down there too. They're a little you definitely can't bring any kind of outside alcohol to their patio or anything like that. They will they do have a guy out there that makes sure to monitor that pretty hardcore, and he will bust your knees. But outside of that, they say it's Vegas law. I'm not going to dispute it. I'll trust that it is. But it was overall really good experience. Hung out there for a little bit, played some Cards Against Humanity, and you know, drank some beer and had a good time. So I enjoyed it. That was probably my favorite. That was my favorite IPA of the trip. My favorite local IPA for sure.
All right. So would you say you were impressed by the Las Vegas craft beer scene, or not impressed and just found a couple of standouts?
I would not say overall it's an impressive beer scene, but it does have a couple of good ones worked in there. It doesn't seem like a place that a whole lot of people really care to try to expand the craft beer scene.
Yeah, I think I was about to say, it reminds me kind of New Orleans, kind of New Orleans-y, where people are there to down like five hand grenades and, you know, show off their butts rather than, you know, pursue some sort of fine dining or fine craft beer experience.
Yeah, now fine dining, that probably is around, but fine craft beer experience, you know, they'll import some dogfish, and, you know, you can pay $14 for that, and that should cover you.
They're more interested in splitting twos than,
exactly
sampling some fine beer.
Yeah, exactly. They're more interested in you throwing $1,000 down per yo bet, you know, stuff like that.
Exactly. All right, well, it's unfortunate that you got the Las Vegas leprosy, but, you know.
Yeah, you know. It happens.
It's the way it goes. It's the price you pay for winning all those hundreds of dollars that you won.
That's the new thing, you know, instead of, if you can't pay them, instead of breaking your knees, they infect you with something, because exactly. It's a little more subtle.
All right, well, let's get on to our beer of episode 80 here. We're going to take on a brewery. We haven't done McKellar either, but we've talked about McKellar before. But this time, we're going to take on Evil Twin Brewing out of New York, I think, officially by way of Copenhagen.
Evil.
When we talk about flavor, we typically think only of our tongues. But flavor is comprised of two sensory systems: the tongue, where we perceive taste, and the nose, where we perceive aroma. And thanks to our biodiversity, we all sense things a little bit differently, which often leads to a wide range of opinions on your favorite beer. The tongue is one of the systems we humans use to push ourselves towards desirable foods and away from dangerous ones, like rancid food or poison. The sense of taste is so important that it has three paths to the brain in case there's a failure along one of those paths. The tongue has about 10,000 taste buds, with a few also sprinkled throughout other parts of your mouth, such as in your cheeks and esophagus. Each taste bud has between 50 and 100 taste receptors that recognize certain molecules in food, and as we age, the number of receptors decline. This is why many elderly have a lack of appetite and a lack of interest in food. This in turn leads to fragility and poor health. Back in the 19th century, we used to think that five different areas of the tongue perceive the different basic tastes, but science has since proven that most of the tongue is perceptive to all the basic tastes: sweet, sour, salty, bitter, and umami. Sweet receptors were used in evolution to point us towards things that had a lot of nutritional value. In the modern era, this has proven troublesome for our bellies, as a sweet taste is always available, and our brains still think we should have this. The ability to detect a sour taste allows us to detect acidity as well as ripe or spoiled food. Salt plays a crucial role to many internal processes that require sodium and potassium, and let's face it, salt tastes really good. Despite the fact that we like hops, bitter senses are used to avoid potentially dangerous toxins like cyanide. But bitterness is a rainbow, and there may be more at work in the brain. Umami translates to pleasant savory taste in Japanese, and its job is to point out savory flavors, which are recognized through receptors looking for glutamate, which is an amino acid used to synthesize protein. The tongue can also perceive other sensations that are not lumped in with the basic tastes: spiciness, pungency, coolness, numbness, astringency, metallics, calcium, fat, temperature, and starch. But taste is only one half of the flavor equation, as our noses also play a crucial role, as we'll find out next time. So today we're talking about Evil Twin Brewing out of New York. Originally, the Evil Twin in question is, I'm going to say it's Jeppe from Copenhagen. His brother is Mikkel Bjergso, who is most famously known for making the Gypsy Brewery, or creating the Gypsy Brewery, McKellar. And
sure.
Probably he's McKellar. Mikkel is probably the more famous of the twins. But Evil Twin is... Jeppe is definitely making a name for himself, at least in the United States. I can't really speak for Copenhagen, but funnily enough, they were both school teachers, and they both decided to leave teaching young minds for brewing, and they hate each other. They really don't like each other. But they both enter brewing, which is a funny little twist of fate there. But yeah, so...
Hence the name Evil Twin?
Yes. Yeah, hence the name Evil Twin. I hope if he's adhering to Star Trek tradition and he has a goatee like Spock and Mirror Mirror, for all you nerds out there.
Has to be the 100% opposite.
Yes,
sure.
Absolutely. I will say that every time, and this is like one of those, everybody has those like little mental hitches, you know, those things you just get stuck on. Every time, and this is, I don't know when this commercial originally came out. It was sometime in the early 2000s. But every time I hear the name Evil Twin, I can't help but think of this Coors commercial.
I love playing two hand touch, eating way too much, watching my team win with the twins. I love quarterbacks eating dirt, pom-poms and short skirts,
Generic, but
twins.
But yeah, the twins. Like that's been stuck in my head since the butt. That like that commercial came out at the height of butt rock. You know, Nickelback was reigning supreme. Probably Puddle of Mud or some others. But yeah, it was the height of butt rock, and that song came. That commercial came out with the twins. And so every time I see Evil Twin, it's just it, like rings in my head. Evil Twin. It's like
I understand. That came to my mind as well.
The Bjergso twins. So every freaking time, it's like some weird sickness in my head. I can't help it.
It's okay.
They do a lot of different beers. Although they do, I know they get a lot more, funnily enough, back in Copenhagen, back in Denmark, than we do. Our pal Stefan, who's going to be here at the end of the month, has vowed to bring us some of the biscotti, the Imperial Biscotti break.
Oh, okay.
Which is very highly rated. I think it's like something like upper 90s for that beer. But they make quite a few beers, and we get a number of them here in the States. I don't know how much the rest of the United States get, but here in Dallas, we get things like the Sunshine something or other. We get the Molotov Cocktail, the Citrus Sunshine, the Molotov Cocktail. We get the Light Molotov. We get the Christmas Eve at a New York City hotel ballroom, or hotel room, sorry. And we get a couple of others. We don't get a lot of their beers, but we get an okay representation of them.
Yeah, so I was going through this list, and I don't recognize really many of these. Like you said, the Christmas Eve at a New York City room, a hotel room, I do recognize. But I like even the Evil Twin Yin, the Twin Yang, Molotov Cocktail, even more Jesus. I mean, I don't recognize any of these.
But the Molotov Cocktail is they have it on it actually right now, Whole Foods Park Lane. I had it today. It's a really dank IPA, Imperial IPA.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's like I want to say it's like somewhere around 13% ABV.
Yeah, 13,
but it's Imperial and it's dank. I mean, it's like drinking some weed.
Oh, okay.
But I will say it's
probably tasty.
Yeah, exactly. I do like about this brewery. He's a little more playful, at least as far as names go, than McKellar is. He's a little like he has a beer called Soft Dookie that you know rates at 3.85. Which is an Imperial Stout. He has the I Love You With My Stout, which we're going to talk about today, which is an Imperial Stout. And he has the Even More Jesus. He has the Molotov Cocktail. He's just a little more whimsical in his right. naming, which is probably appropriate for having a goatee and being the Evil Twin.
That is very true, yes. So he is the Evil Twin.
He is the Evil Twin, yes.
Oh, perfect.
Yes.
I didn't know if he hated his other twin so much that he called him the Evil Twin.
I mean, maybe
if he embraces being the Evil Twin.
But if you really are the Evil Twin, do you really consider yourself the Evil Twin, or is it really the other twin is always the Evil Twin?
I would think it's always the other twin's the Evil Twin.
But I guess he recognizes that having a goatee, that must make him the Evil Twin, because if you have a goatee, it means you're evil.
Right.
The presence of facial hair indicates a villainous nature.
That's why we're so evil.
Exactly. Exactly.
We're the bearded guys with the fail smiles on the Twitter feed.
Yes, we're very extremely evil.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, I mean, their top 10 beers are all very highly rated. 3.59 to 4.09, which, you know, is basically around the range of 87 to 99 to 100 based on the rate beer scale. So, you're going to be doing pretty well with any of these, any of their top beers and their most rated beers, which to me means they're probably the most available. So that gives an overall impression that this brewery makes some pretty good stuff.
And one other hit before we move on to the review, one other hitch in my brain, I'm just going to mention here. I'm going to do my impression here in a second, but there's the Evil Twin Falco IPA, which when I see the name Edie Falco, another mental hitch in my brain is I have to do my impression of Edie Falco from The Sopranos. And my entire impression...
What character would she be talking to when you do this?
Mostly Tony, generally, or perhaps a character known as Furio.
Yeah, I thought Furio might make an appearance.
She often called out his name, and my impression consists of the following. 3, 2, 1. Furio!
See, that's better than I thought. I thought you were just going to say, hi, I'm Edie Falco, just in your normal voice.
No, it's an actual impression.
Oh,
or, Tony! You know, I have a very wide range of impressions, and most of them consist of Edie Falco yelling. Impressions.
And yelling. Yeah.
Furio. Oh, it's always yelling. She does nothing but yell in that show, but it's always, Furio.
Marco.
There's one of the episodes, and they're playing Marco Polo, and it's always,
Marco.
Oh,
Furio. Tony.
So there ends my career as an impressionist. Yeah. I will not be getting on Johnny Carson with my limited impressions of Edie Falco.
So we cut off the comedy right there, and then we go back to the beer talk right here. So we just
three,
so they know for the
two,
time life when they're making that.
One, back to beer.
Yeah, exactly. So Evil Twin, contract brewer, I'm taking it. I don't know that for a fact, but just taking a look here, considering everything was brewed at Two Roads Brewing or Westbrook Brewing, I'm assuming they're contract brewing everywhere.
I think so. Maybe they are a gypsy brewer too. I don't honestly know. You're the researcher on this show. You should know this by now.
Well, maybe I'll talk about that whenever I actually talk about Evil Twin Brewing and its founding.
Maybe if you weren't so damn sick, you would have done a little research for the show and actually served it right and told us whether they're a gypsy or a normal brewer.
That's true. I forgot to do that.
I feel like we should just scrap this entire episode right now. We know nothing about Evil Twin except that he has a goatee, and I do a really good Edie Falco impression.
Which has everything to do with Evil Twin.
Absolutely.
And you got to think of your Coors commercial, so,
sorry.
You know.
Twins! All right, well, right after this, we will get on with Evil Twin, we'll grow our own goatees, we'll stroke each other's goatees, with the I Love You with my stout.
Twins! Evil Twin Brewing is a gypsy brewery originating in Denmark. Founded in 2010 by Jeppe Jarnett Bjertso, a former school teacher, Evil Twin produces limited edition and one-off beers, as well as a series of seasonal and year-round beers available internationally. Evil Twin says, quote, "We are so much in love with good taste, all the beers from Evil Twin are prepared in 10 of the best breweries around the world, exclusively handpicked to please you with delicate, funky, extreme, and by all means rare flavors. Maybe not the easiest way, but certainly the most fun." Unquote. Evil Twin Brewing is opening its first standalone brewery and taproom in 2017 in Ridgewood, Queens. The space will be located at 1616 George Street in Ridgewood in a former banquet hall and will provide nearly 10,000 square feet of production room. And it will also provide an additional 4,000 square feet for a taproom and outdoor area. This new space will allow the team to be able to brew 5,000 to 8,000 barrels of beer while still producing beers with other breweries it has contracts with currently.
So the BJCP for an Imperial Stout. Its overall impression is that it should be intensely flavored big dark ale with a wide range of flavor balances and regional interpretations. Kind of generic.
Very generic.
And I just knocked over the I Love You with the Must Out bottle right there.
Oh, so, okay. Did you pour it all over the place?
Fortunately, the bottle was empty. It was all in my glass.
Oh, okay.
The ABV on this is 12%. ABU is none. Should be served in a snifter. And the description of this beer is it's a very haughty description when you compare it to his beer names, but... The only description that is from Jeppe Bjergso, he said, "When I copied the famous Even More Jesus, I had to ask myself as an artist, why am I doing this? I didn't honestly know. It was just an instinct about beer as pure form. In a sense, the stout is like a metaphor for freedom, the sum of all the beauty that surrounds me and my perfect contemporary existence."
Wow.
That's very haughty.
He is the evil twin.
That's very haughty.
Now... The ratings do reflect that perhaps the haughty tone did deliver a really good beer, because Beer Advocate gives it 92 out of 100. Rate Beer gives it 99 overall and 87 in style. And Untapped, right on the precipice of 4 at 3.99 out of 5.
So let's start with aroma. It should be rich and complex with variable amounts of roasted grains, maltiness, fruity esters, hops, and alcohol. The roasted malt character can take on coffee, dark chocolate, or slightly burnt tones and can be light to moderately strong. And I would expect with a big Imperial Stout like this, and especially with the high alcohol content, we should probably get just a snootful of snout.
Just right in your face.
Just all in your... Just an explosion in your face.
A snoot snoutful.
Surprisingly, though, when you take a big whiff, I know you're clogged up with the Las Vegas leprosy there.
Yeah,
but
I was going to say, I'm going to have to more rely on you, unfortunately.
Yeah, unfortunately, there's not a strong smell there. I mean, it's pretty much straight up. If you smelled a Guinness, you smelled this beer.
I was going to say, I get maybe a hint of alcohol aroma, but that's about it.
I mean,
it's not very strong.
It's very much a standard stout smell. Now, it's not necessarily a bad thing. It's just that what I don't see here is anything bold, at least aroma-wise. It's not like, wham, there's something. It's not like, you know.
Nothing bold within your perfect existence.
It's not doing a boom, boom in my nose. There's no wham dancing on the tip of my nose there. It's just standard stout.
Doesn't drop a deuce of aroma?
No, there's it's not like a deuce in the night in my nose. It's just a standard stout. That's not revved
up
a bad
like
thing.
A deuce?
Yeah, it's not revved up like a deuce in my nose. It's just a standard stout. It's not a bad thing. It just is what it is. It's stout.
I have smelled a Guinness, so I'm going to compare and say I at least know what you're talking about.
Yeah, it's nothing.
I'm treating it like I am the listener, since I can't fully embrace the aroma. And you did a good job, Mark. You made it relatable to me, the common man listener.
I appreciate it. That's what I strive for, is just working my way down slowly to that common man level.
I know you got to come down from your perfect existence level.
I know.
Level.
I got these lofty peaks in which I reside. Now, the appearance. Color may range from very dark reddish-brown to jet black. Definitely going to be opaque, being a stout. Deep tan to dark brown head. Generally has a well-formed head, although head retention may be low to moderate. I got to say, for this beer, it pours a nice tan head, and boy, does it retain. I was very surprised. A lot of the beers we've had lately, when they talk about head retention, have fizzled out or have a very thin ring of head on them. And as someone who respects and enjoys good head, this beer has some good head. This might be the best head we've seen since that last Peter North video we watched together, well, hand in hand.
That's true. Well, yeah, or anything going on with the farm that we can't talk about on this show. But, you know, that's kind of funny because I too have a snifter, and I did pour it into it. And I know it's a snifter that you're well aware of, Mark, since it is one from Lakewood. We both have plenty of these. And I would say the head retention's decent. It's decent. It's not not quite as good as it is with yours.
Maybe you poured it incorrectly, because on mine I have about 3/4 of an inch of head on this, which is pretty good little head. Pretty good little head.
It's better than most, but I just wouldn't say it's like over the top crazy like you're noting. At least not the one I did.
It definitely reminds me of a proper, in some ways, a proper Guinness pour. Got its nice velvety smooth head on it, which is
it's a little chocolatier looking than a Guinness is too, so I actually kind of like this one.
It is. I'm just saying I'm not usually impressed by beer head, but I'm impressed by this one because it's a standout amongst our recent beers.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, the most important is, of course, flavor and mouthfeel, and it should be rich, deep, and complex, and frequently quite intense, with variable amounts of roasted malt grains, maltiness, fruity esters, hot bitterness, and flavor, and alcohol with medium to aggressively high bitterness. Mouthfeel should be full-bodied and chewy, with a velvety, luscious texture. So I'm expecting that... I'm guessing it's going to be more like... just a little more on the darker, bitter side of stouts.
Sure.
Just judging... Just taking a random wild guess here. Maybe more like
I expect it to be boozy, too.
Yeah, like an old Rasputin or something like that.
It is 12%.
Yes. And probably going to be a little bit boozy, 12%. Absolutely.
Right. Man, there's some alcohol flavoring in there.
It is, but it's not as boozy as you would think.
There's definitely some bitterness in there, too.
Yeah, and that bitterness is not coming...
I would say it's closer to the aggressively high than it is the medium, if I had to pick. It's got a pretty good little bit of bitter in there.
It is. It's not coming from the hops. I mean, there's no IBU in this beer. So whatever they're using to make this beer, it's definitely lending that bitter quality that you would normally get from the hops.
Wow.
What's the right word for it?
Bitter.
Thank you. Bitter. But it's like almost like a cigarette. I mean, it's like a...
It's
tobacco-ish. It kind of reminds me of an American Spirit cigarette in a way. It's a little more raw.
Those are super raw, yes.
Yeah, just a little more. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. It's not wet cigarettes like we saw with Angel City Brewing.
Right.
It's not wet cigarettes. It's like, it's an American Spirit in flavor. That's not necessarily a bad thing if you enjoy a cigarette at 2 a.m.
You know, maybe like a really dry Baker's chocolate or something, too. Like, it's got that unsweet... bitter chocolate taste to me a little bit. I don't know. It's just it. I think the stout flavorings always, you know, kind of remind me of chocolate anyway. It's just that intense bitterness if you had absolutely no sweetness involved at all. Like if you just ate a brick of that stuff you could buy at the Walmart, not the back of the shelf frosting, but the Baker's chocolates they have. Man, it's interesting. It's not necessarily a bad thing. It's just interesting the way it comes across.
Yeah, it's definitely, there's not a lot of sweetness here. It's like if you took the base of a Guinness, appropriately so, given the, you know, how classic of a stout that is, and then you just started chunking in, like, charcoal or cigarettes, and you just, like, decided to grind up an American Spirit, a pack of American Spirits. It kind of reminds me, appropriately so, of the quote that Johnny B. provided us of Tom Waits. It kind of reminds me of Tom Waits' voice. It's like, at first you're like, do I like this? And then you get under the body of it, and you're like, I like this. And then you smash it on the ground like Thor.
Yeah.
But I kind of like that. I got to say, kind of like this beer. I don't normally... It takes a turn. Like, Angel City takes a turn where it goes from American Spirit to, wet cigarette in a hot garbage pile.
Like if you're living on the streets and you found a gutter cigarette,
And
you try to smoke it, that's what that was.
You found like half of a Lucy.
But see, the interesting thing is they note Sierra Nevada Narwhal as a commercial example of the style. I would not say it's anything like that.
No,
I would also say it's not like
Narwhal is far more sweeter than this is.
Yeah, the Great Divide Yeti Imperial Stout sweeter. This is probably the most bitter of any of these examples. The Bell's Expedition. I haven't had the Cigar City one, but just all these other ones. They do mention Old Rasputin. That's probably the one that's closest to, I would say.
Yeah, I agree. Examples here. I think it's almost, I don't want to say a clone, because it's been years since I've had Old Rasputin, but it most reminds me of Old Rasputin for sure.
Yeah, it's very similar to Old Rasputin Imperial, if anybody's had that out there, which you should have if you're listening to a craft beer podcast.
Now, going over some of the user reviews from Rate Beer, which, by the way, our inside sources tell us that Rate Beer may be dying slowly.
Which actually to me is unfortunate, because I prefer it out of the two beer rating sites.
Yeah, if you
Untappd is the best, but out of the two regular sites, I like it the best.
The thing is, people don't tend to comment on Untappd; they just tend to log.
Right. Yeah, exactly. That's what I like about Rate Beer.
And people are apparently really unsatisfied with Beer Advocate, and then Rate Beer apparently has the best. I think it has the best user generated content, but apparently they may be on the way out. So we'll see.
Interesting.
But this one guy from Dorkenstein. Says rum was a peat, balsamic vinegar, alcohol, and charcoal ash. I would say charcoal ash is probably appropriate.
Yeah.
I don't necessarily taste balsamic vinegar there, but definitely charcoal ash.
Peat and dark chocolate, I get that.
Yes. Soy sauce, I don't get that at all. I think maybe you say soy, it almost makes me think he had a bad beer, like he had an infected beer.
Yeah, I don't get soy sauce at all. Charcoal char, I get dark chocolate and peat. I get all of that, but yeah, soy sauce and balsamic vinegar. I'm with you. I don't get either one of those.
It's like if you took a West Virginia or a Kentucky mine, a piece of charcoal from there. You mix it up with a little bit of chocolate, a little bit of stevia, and you popped it in your mouth. Just crunch down on that charcoal nugget. That's kind of what this beer is like. It's not so bad. Yeah, I mean it's a regular snack in my house.
Right.
Coke Monkey says he says it's sugary, which I don't agree with. I don't think it's sugary at all.
No.
And he says natural cinnamon stick, pumpkin spice, cocoa, whiskey barrel, and grass.
I'm going to say I disagree with Coke Monkey.
And condensed milk. Yeah, I don't get
it. Maybe it's all the Coke he had.
It might be that constant blood streaming from his nostrils. He describes it more as like a sweeter beer than it is, and it's definitely not a sweet stout. It's definitely more of a thicker, more acidic, bitter stout.
Yeah, a medium dense brown sugar. I mean, no, I don't see that at all.
No, it's like he's describing just something like it's like he's. He's the evil twin for this beer. He's tasting like the alternate dimension of this beer, and that's not what that is.
Now, did you get Stefan on the line so he can read the last one from Malmo?
No. I just want to say, being a native Dane, I have to say I agree with this last guy, Lilja. He said, Flaska från Galatia, smak ochdoft af mörk flurfer chocolate, kladaka, kaffe lakrits, lakra special, brunt socker, rund och klin, kraftfull, nagert kregnig, tor lagum, saltna, finbeska, gott! Now, do you agree with that?
Only with parts, not the complete sentence, but he definitely had a couple of he or she definitely had a couple of high points.
I don't know that I agree with Nagar Kramjik, but when he or she says Finbeska, yes, absolutely, I agree.
I don't know about Brunt Soccer.
Yeah, Brunt Soccer.
I'm wary of that.
No. I'm more of a Brunt Football.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's more where I view this beer. Sure, I'm totally against the Flaska from Galatea, but
the football because that's what created the Coors Twins.
Exactly. Twins.
So, yeah, otherwise, what was your point of living at the time?
Exactly. I just lived for that commercial, nothing else. All right, ratings.
Ratings. So, I didn't know exactly what to expect from this beer. I'm not the stout guy. I'm the IPA guy. Mark's the stout guy.
Am I a stout guy? I feel like neither of us is the stout guy.
No, that's true.
I feel
you're,
like
you're a porter guy, I guess. You're the darker beer guy.
Then. I'm the darker beer guy, which I guess as a subsection of being darker beer guy, I guess stout would follow in that.
But you become the stout guy.
As a subsection of my life, stout guy does fall into that. It's like if I'm the Justice League, stout guy is in there in the team for sure. But I also have bourbon.
Your team, yes.
Yeah, I have bourbon barrel guy. I've got other dark beer guys that I can't think of right now.
You got porter guy.
Porter guy, Imperial Porter guy, Pumpkin Ale guy. Yeah. There's a number of dark beer, fanatics in my little superhero team. But I don't often reach for the stouts anymore, just a pure stout. So,
interesting.
But I guess if being dark beer guy means I'm stout guy.
Exactly.
Then I'm stout guy.
So, that being said, Mark is stout guy. So it's less likely to be in my range of my preferred palate, but. This one's interesting. It does taste a lot like an old Rasputin, which is one of the first stouts that I actually had a long time ago, and I did enjoy it at the time. And this one tastes very similar. When I do go for these type of stouts and porters and that kind of thing, when I go for darker beers in general, I tend towards probably a little sweeter than this. They don't have to be chocolate, but not quite as edgy as this normally. And when I go for IPAs, I do love the harsh IPAs. The hoppier, the better. I love the doubles right before they go triple and get sweeter. So I definitely don't have a problem with harsh bitterness. I do like that. I'm just not as big of a fan of it in the heavier dark beers. This particular one, though, I will say, even though I called it a heavier dark beer, the thickness is pretty solid. Pretty good. It's not overly heavy. It's not real weighty. It's not too chewy or rough or anything. It's got a good balance to it. Far supreme to a Guinness, for sure, if someone's going to just compare it to a standard stout that everyone has had or can at least have access to. amazingly enough, after saying all this about it, I may reach for one of these again because as it warms, as I continue to drink it and as it warms, I feel like the harsh edge tends to fall off a little bit, and it's bringing out some of the smoother underlying flavors of more of your standard stout that's not quite as edgy. And the booze is hidden really well in it, too. I figured at 12%, there's definitely a shot that it could have been real boozy. Not that I'm necessarily against that, but I prefer it to be a little more balanced. And this one does a good job of balancing it. So overall, I was much more impressed with this beer than I expected to be after the first sip. I had no expectations going into it, but after the first sip, I was like, yeah, this is actually starting to balance out quite a bit. I would suggest let it warm up just a touch. I would suggest giving it, at least half a glass or more before you judge it. But based on that, I'm actually going to give this stout a 4.25 out of 5.
I have to agree a lot with you because one thing I was about to say was as this beer warms up, I'm noticing more flavors. And that's a good thing because it's revealing itself. It's pulling back the kimono a little bit to show its inner taint. And I'm getting a little bit of cherry taint there and a little bit of sweet cherry on the back end, which is nice. It's definitely a better beer.
It's showing under boob and under ass.
Little side boob on it.
The bottom of the butt cheeks.
It's showing you the taint without showing you the rest of the package, as it were.
Right.
Just the gooch in the middle. But it's showing a lot more. Behind it, which is nice, because I would say you absolutely need to give this beer time to warm up. And I would say take it, to have a couple of swigs when you first pour it from the bottle fresh cold, for sure. And then give it about 15 minutes to warm up. And maybe, set it beside a fire, maybe stoke a fire, sit there and, put on your velvet robe, your smoking jacket.
Put it on a hot plate.
Put on a hot plate. You'll notice some new flavors there, which is nice. It's good to see. It's a really cool thing. Cool, as Rory Gilmore likes to say, it's cool. It's a really cool thing to see the beer warm up and to reveal a whole new palette of flavors, which is nice.
I mean, watching it's not that fun, but the taste.
Right. We sat here and stared at it for a good 15 minutes. That's the magic of the show, is we sat at a hot plate. We each had a hot plate, and we sat and watched it warm up.
We got the hot plates at the same time.
We got it to a nice rolling boil on the hot plate. I'm gonna give this beer my name for this beer is Last Call Casualty, because to me this beer is like, first of all, 2 a.m. you're at some just absolute dive of a sports bar and you're going for that Last Call Casualty. You're taking your first drag at 2 a.m. on that American Spirit. It tastes so good. this beer like masks the booze so well. You're on a that dangerous precipice. You're about to fall over and probably need an ambulance. Like I may have been guilty of, my 35th birthday. You're gonna settle up next to that last call casualty, the bar, that Sheila Sauvage. Everything seems so right with that beer, and then the ABV hits you, and you wake up the next morning, and you're like, oh my god, what did I do? And that's not a knock against the bar or against the beer. It's just the fact that it seems so right and it tastes so good at the time.
You're like, why do I only have 3 American Spirits left in my shirt pocket here?
That's right, and yeah, and why am I waking up with 3 condoms on my head?
Right.
It's just the way it goes.
And one's still on. What's going on here?
Yeah. It's just the way it is. I have condoms in my hands. I've got condoms on my junk. I've got condoms on my head. I've got one condom on one toe. Right. And a dental dam plastered to my face. And that's just the way it goes. And that,
but
this
you're
is,
alone. That's the weird part.
Yeah, but you're alone. Yeah. Sheila Sauvage, you were too weird for Sheila Sauvage. She fled the scene of the crime. But that it feels right at the time. And that's what this beer is, because it masked the booze so well. 12% ABV. I honestly, it's not that boozy at all. For 12%, you don't. The booze is very minor here, and that's why it's a threat. It's a minor threat, but it's a threat. And so I applaud Jeppe for. I think it's a damn good stout. I think it's a lot of fun. I love his beer names, and I think it does a damn good representation of what it's trying. Now, not a super just pure stout fan, but I think it's. Well represented for what it is, a decent successor to Old Rasputin, because Old Rasputin's kind of played out at this point. But a damn good job. I love the way it reveals more
Old
flavors
Rasputin's
as it warms
on the market.
Up. It is. I'm just saying it's kind of played out in a lot of ways. But I love the way it reveals new flavors as it warms up, much as you, as you warm up a lady, you might find some new flavors there at about 3 a.m., 3:30 at the bar. So I think I'm going to go spot on, point on, match set with you. I'm going to give it a 4.25 out of 5, giving us a final score of, from the Las Vegas Leper, 4.25 out of 5. Well, thanks for listening to the show, and thanks for all your support. Thanks for listening to episode 80 of Brew Bloods.
I'm impressed that you were able to do that math in your head.
I know. That's why they call me the Albert Einstein of beer.
You were able to add 4.25 and 4.25 and divide it by 2.
That's right. That's right. Thanks to Johnny B for the quote. Really appreciate it. He helped. He not only helped us with the quote, he helped us get Tom Waits in studio just to issue that quote. If you do us a favor. Leave us a review on iTunes. It would help us. Helps other people find us. If you have a friend that enjoys craft beer, that enjoys podcasts, enjoys audio, enjoys hearing things, point them in our direction. We'd appreciate it. Just go to brewbloods.net for all the links to that.
If you have a friend with a podcast app that you can subscribe them to our show, and then just don't even make them aware of it. If they don't care about podcasts but they have the app, throw us on there.
That's right.
What does it hurt?
That's right. They might find something fun in their feed next time. If you have any feedback on the show, you can email us at brewbloodshow@gmail.com. You can call us 469-573-BEER. That's 469-573-2337. Check us out on the social networks. We are Brew Bloods on just about every single platform, including Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Untapped. And
brewbloodshow@gmail.com.
brewbloodshow@gmail.com. And you can follow Dustin at DWS9775. I am at the Mark with a C on Twitter. And that's about it. I can't believe we've done 80 weeks of the show without a break. But that's the commitment we have to you, the Brew Bloods P1.
It shows how much we like to drink.
Well, that might be a more important statement that we might need to seek out the 12 steps.
There you go.
All right, we'll catch you guys next week for episode 81, Brew Bloods.
Probst.